Today, I've got something special to share. I just received this kit in the mail, which includes this chip, which is likely different from any other you've come across before, because this chip is the first of its kind to be made publicly available. It's custom manufactured using over 150 distinct designs submitted by an open source community. The designs on this chip are not just from seasoned professionals. They're also from enthusiasts, hobbyists, and total beginners of all ages. If you're one of the people whose design is included on this chip, congratulations and thank you for contributing. If you have one of these kits, or you're just here because you're curious to see what the community has made, I'm going to give a quick tour of the board and some of the on-chip projects and show you how to get started. So let's crack on. A year ago, I joined the 0 to ASIC course hosted by Matt Venn, with the promise that for a surprisingly low price, someone like me with no prior experience could learn to design a chip, an ASIC or application-specific integrated circuit, and actually get it manufactured. Matt Venn also leads the Tiny Tapeout program that enables the manufacturing, and while I had just missed out on joining this original TT02 shuttle run, it was exciting to watch Matt and the Tiny Tapeout team do the world's first live chip bring up, and I joined the waitlist to purchase one of the few spare boards not already allocated to the original contributors. And that's what we have here now. Taking a quick look at the board, we see the main ASIC, the crown jewel of custom-made silicon, which is mounted on a carrier that acts as a breakout board, and that is plugged into the demo board, which provides input, output, and some other basic control. PCB manufacturing was made possible by the sponsorship of a number of companies, with Efabless also facilitating the ASIC's manufacture. The board design is by Pat Deegan of Psychogenic Technologies, and I must say this kit looks and feels pretty nice, so thanks Pat. Okay, let's get into it already. Time to plug the board in and see what happens. Use a USB-C cable just for power delivery. Some future versions will also use it for computer control. Straight away, we see life. From the factory, these dip switches select the active design, which we'll fiddle with later. My board has design number 131 selected, which is a simple hello world that we'll explore in a moment. We see the power good LEDs and a flickering GPIO LED. An internal CPU drives it, but the designs themselves are free-running hard circuits in silicon. The 8 digital outputs from the chip each drive a segment of this LED display, which this design uses to display hello, albeit a bit fast out of the box. Note that the outputs are also available on the pins labelled OUT 0 to OUT 7. Up here, there is a jumper which connects an onboard 20 MHz oscillator, supplying the ASIC's main system clock, and if we disconnect it, we see that the design freezes, as well as the GPIO LED, indicating a halt in the on-chip CPU as well as in the so-called scan chain logic that links all the designs. Replacing the jumper to the same position lets everything carry on again. The chip has 8 digital inputs, which can be turned on or off using the dip switches over here. Switching left is off, right is on. As with the outputs, these inputs also have pins on the side, labelled IN0 to IN7. Just be aware that if you intend to drive any externally, their respective dip switches should be in the off position. Up here is a reset button and a clock button, each with a debouncing circuit to ensure clean switching. The clock button is actually wired directly to IN0 and the reset button to IN1. In TT02 and 03, these signals are just by convention, and not all designs use them for the same purposes. TT04 and above have dedicated clock and reset lines and offer more I/O. Here, with the reset button pressed and asserting the IN1 signal, this hello design actually uses the signal for its own clock divider option, hence slowing it down a bit. The clock button can be used to send individual clock pulses via IN0, but with this slow jumper connected, the ASIC is actually generating that IN0 clock internally itself. If we remove the slow jumper, the GPIO LED keeps blinking, but the design halts, and the clock button would now allow us to single step the design's clock if we wanted to control it directly. Now let's explain how we can actually change the generated slow clock signal by dividing it. This is an important testing feature that is part of the ASIC itself, not of this one design. When replacing the slow jumper or when powering up the board, the rising edge on this slow clock enable signal causes the binary number presented by the input switches to be sampled and latched at that moment, thus used as the input value for the slow clock divider, before the inputs are then fed directly into the design. In other words, if you were to turn on all the switches and then replace the slow jumper, the input value for the slow clock divider would be the maximum of 255, hence dividing the clock by 512, to make it just under 10 Hz, according to this formula as found in the demo board's technical notes. In this case, our original slow clock divider input was 128, to divide the clock by 258. And I've now switched it to 254, to divide the clock by 510, as we again place the slow clock jumper. Switching all the inputs back to the normal running state for this design, we see now that it is approximately half the speed. I'm going to count how many iterations the design completes in 60 seconds. The design goes through a total of 16 distinct states, and we can use a total count of iterations in a given time frame to calculate the approximate slow clock rate. In this case, it's about 36 iterations, so if we divide that number by 60 seconds and multiply it by the 16 states, we get pretty close to the calculated slow clock of 9.8 Hz. There are 161 distinct designs on this chip, so let's take a look at a couple more that are easy enough to verify on this board. Changing the project selection DIP switches allows us to select the active design in real time. The datasheet of each design shows you how to set the project selection DIP switches. Here I'm selecting design 0, which is a straight through inverter design. Each input signal, if low, becomes a high output signal, and vice versa. For my inputs in this case, IN7 is high, IN0 is being driven by the slow clock, and all other inputs are low. As a result, we see the LED segment for IN0 blinking because of the inverted slow clock, the dot is not lit because it's the LED segment for IN7, and the rest are lit up as the inverse of other low inputs. Inputs would float when switched off, but the ASIC has enabled pull-down resistors internally. By bad luck, or maybe me being a bit rough, my input DIP switches don't always fully register the on state. So to work around this, I wired up some external DIP switches via the input header pins, ran them through a 1K 8-way resistor network to 3.3 volts, and switched off all the input DIPs on the demo board. These external DIP switches seem to do the trick. And with that done, we now move on to design 68, which is called Breathing LED. With this one, I adjusted my camera to make the effect more visible, and I had to run the slow clock at the full speed of 2500 Hz by ensuring all input DIPs were off before power up. This design demonstrates PWM, or pulse width modulation, which can be seen as a gradual pulsating effect on the top LED segment. All other LED segments are showing the internal state of the PWM. I've also hooked up my oscilloscope to out 0, and we can see the slowly increasing and decreasing duty cycle of the PWM waveform that creates the pulsating effect. Next up, it's design 28, loading animation. This design is one of many on the chip that was drawn out as a schematic using Walkwi, so you can easily go and simulate it yourself online. I've started up my slow clock at full speed this time. The fixed appearance of the GPIO LED is a clue of that. This design uses a negative reset on IN1, so I switch it high to let the design run, and an LED segment slowly makes its way around the display. If we switch on IN2, it appears to do nothing now, but this has actually disabled the design's own clock divider, which means it's running too fast to be seen. By flipping a couple of the higher input switches and toggling the slow clock enable jumper, we can see the effect at more sensible speeds. Slow, at about 12.5 Hz, then a little faster at 18.7 Hz, and a fair bit faster than that at 35.7 Hz. How about a bit of sound now? Design 37, Siren, is meant to run at 12.5 kHz, but for now I'll be running it 5 times slower at 2.5 kHz. Its audio output is out 7 and is intended to drive a piezo speaker, but I've put it through a simple resistor voltage divider so it produces line out levels to drive the auxiliary input of an amplified speaker. From power on, it plays various tones and provides a pretty display on the 7 segment LEDs. I would need to provide an external clock to go faster than this, but instead I've sped up the footage by 5 times to demonstrate how the design was intended to play out. While I've given a brief overview of some of the simpler designs on the TT02 ASIC, there's plenty more to be seen. Examples of more sophisticated designs include Design 36, which presents 1,000 digits of pi, Design 2, which drives a character LCD display, Design 25, which transmits different messages via UART signalling, Design 75, which is an internal high-speed ring oscillator, many small CPU designs, some with SPI memory access, some small-scale implementations of FPGAs, and many other visual and audio effects, puzzles, controllers, and maths devices. So what comes next? Well, if there's more you'd like to know about a particular design or other features of the ASIC or board, let me know. If you've got a design on the TT02 chip, post a comment to let me know and optionally discuss it, or otherwise consider making a video of your own. And be sure to jump into the Tiny Tapeout Discord to discuss your findings. If you'd like to be involved in a future production run, particularly as the technology offering and tools improve, check out tinytapeout.com or see the description of this video. Please give this video a thumbs up if you found it useful or if you find this new frontier exciting. And if you would like to see more chip design, electronics, or my projects in general, please also consider subscribing to my channel. Looking forward, I'm more interested in TT03, which should be coming soon with a doubled clock and more designs, including a tiny one of my own, and then TT04 and 05, which are being manufactured at the time of this recording. These newer generations, including the upcoming TT06, were recently teased with a prototype TT03.5 demo, and offer options for more design area, a lot more I/O, bandwidth on the order of 30 MHz, and analog and mixed signal design support as of TT06. Since discovering Tiny Tapeout in the 02 ASIC course, I'm addicted. I've got designs on all of the Tiny Tapeout shuttles starting with TT03. I think I've got a bit of a problem, but I love it.